You've been standing an awfully long time. Please sit. Well, I wonder how many of you thought about this gospel reading all week long. Or did you even know it was coming? It's one I think that we're very familiar with. We see it all over our tradition and our world. I thought about it when I went to the gym this week. Why did I go to the gym? I have no idea. I don't want to admit it. But maybe you thought about it when you used a dollar bill, if you do that anymore. You flipped it over and you saw on the back side, "In God We Trust," the hallmark of our American identity. Maybe you use the debit card and you don't have to think about it anymore. Maybe that's the blessing or the curse of technology, I'm not sure. Maybe you thought about it when you saw the stock market slide and those dollars seemed to fly faster than you could give them away. Maybe you thought about it when you heard the news of Ebola and you heard the debate immediately ensue. We need to close the borders and keep those people there. And I hope and trust that we don't really believe that that's going to happen or that we can do that. But as Christians, we're called to act with compassion and to face what comes our way and let God take care of Ebola and try to help in that. But whatever the stress that you face this week, there was the challenge to your Christian identity, and I think that it's summed up in this gospel reading today. And it's been a question for the church for millennia, and it's still a question for us. It's a gospel reading that has been used to justify the separation of church and state. Give to the emperor, the emperor's, give to God what is God's, and make sure there's a clean line right down the middle. It's been used to justify that Christians can give to the emperor and still be good Christians. So it's been used in quite the opposite way, to support the state. And every degree in between. But I suggest to you that I think we've misunderstood this scripture for most of our time. Because I don't really think that this is the question that's being posed to Jesus, and certainly not the response that Jesus makes. You see, the story falls within Matthew's gospel in what are called the conflict stories, and we've been hearing them, well, in most churches for weeks, but we've been doing special liturgies, so anyway. But he's in conflict with those in authority all the time, and the question that gets posed to him is usually not a question that really matters, but it's a trap that's set to say, you know, where do you come from and what are you about? And so I think that the real stories about the identity of Jesus, his self-understanding, if you will. And in today's story, it's just a genius and a marvel of human ingenuity that they can put this question together that he can't get out of. If he answers that, yes, you should pay tax to the emperor, the Pharisees can scream because they know that that's against the Torah and that you can't pay the tax to a foreign power. And this tax is not just any tax. They have lots of taxes. This tax is actually a tax that was leveled on the people who were being oppressed. Those who were subject to the Roman Empire, but not citizens of it. So it would be particularly heinous for a good, believing, faithful, pious Jew to pay that tax. It would be essentially the same as blasphemy. And yet if he goes along with the Herodians, then the Jews have all the ammunition that they need. He's supporting the empire. He can't possibly be the Son of God. What's more interesting and what's more intriguing about this is it's a real glimpse, I think, into the human condition. Because here you have two completely opposing parties. I'm not sure they could even stand to be in the same room together, collaborating, working out what they wanted to. I can deal with my enemy as long as they're going to help my cause. Maybe that's why we should keep them close to us. Right? It can be useful. But Jesus is brilliant in his response to us and in this story. And I mean, just think about it. It's so interesting. When he says, you know, what coin? Bring me this coin so I can see this coin. He's essentially saying, I'm not familiar with it. I don't even know what it is, right? And then when he gets the coin, he asks the most stupefying question. Whose image is this? And who is this person? What's his title? What's he about? Well, the image on the coin is the emperor's. The emperor of the world. You would have to be born under a rock and live in darkness to not know that. But in saying that, Jesus seems to completely say, this is not part of my reality, so you're going to have to help me out with it. And then, just imagine this, right? Here is, in our Christian belief and tradition, and in Matthew's community certainly, the Son of God looking at a coin that has an image that says Caesar Augustus. Caesar, son of a divine being, the divine being Augustus. And essentially, Caesar, son of a god. It doesn't get much better than that. I mean, it just does not get much better than that. The irony is just so striking. And what Jesus says is, give the coin back to this person and give to God what is God's. Many scholars suggest that the really edgy thing that Jesus is saying is give the land to God. That no empire can rule over this land, that it's God's. And it has to belong to God. Now this is kind of striking also when you consider that Matthew is writing to a community that's living in the absence of the temple, that's living in a homeland that isn't their homeland anymore because now another occupying party is ruling over them, the Romans. So they're more than displaced. They are completely without identity. In the absence of the temple. Now the beauty of our lectionary cycle and the way that the readings have been put together today is that they just fit together like bookends. Doesn't always happen, but today it did. The first reading out of the Hebrew Bible, the reading that's from Isaiah, comes from a time when the people are returning from the exile, from the greatest oppression they've ever known, the oppression of the Babylonians, which exiled them from the land, destroyed the first temple that they had built, and said essentially, your God is useless. And they thought so too. If the God of Israel could not beat the God of the Babylonians, we must find another God. But as the people come back into the land, they are able to rebuild the temple. And they're able to rebuild the temple with the assistance of the foreigners who don't know the God of Israel. And so what happens in their religious understanding is that the God of Israel is not dead. The God of Israel rather stands again, is resurrected. But now the God of Israel is the God of all the nations. Not this particular people or that particular people. And in the story of Isaiah, God is speaking, saying, I know you by name, I call you by name, but you don't quite know me yet, but you're going to know me. And the way that you're going to know me is when you practice compassion, and when you practice justice, and when you don't see the world divided with these territories anymore. And I'll be the God of all the nations. And then on the other end of the bookend, you have this letter from Paul, the first letter of the Thessalonians. It's the earliest Christian writing that we have. It's certainly Paul's first letter, but it's the first of the Christian writings. And all it's really concerned to say is what Paul says in that very last sentence or two: Jesus Christ is raised from the dead. God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now we know the God of the nations in this person of Jesus Christ. And then we come to the gospel, which puts Jesus dead center between these two readings. And Jesus is posed this question. And Jesus' reply is, I'm not concerned with the empires of this world. I'm concerned with God's kingdom. Now, like most questions, this doesn't go unanswered. When you come to the end of Matthew's gospel, this question is posed again, not in the form of paying taxes to the emperor or not, but the fundamental issue of the question: is it the emperor's kingdom or is it God's kingdom? And the question isn't posed to Jesus, the question is posed to all the people. And so once again, in this brilliant insight into the human condition, the Pharisees and all of those religious officials decide, we're not sure about this kingdom of Jesus. We don't like the kingdom of Rome. But, and so the question is, by Pontius Pilate, I've got two people here. I've got Jesus Barabbas, literally son of the father, Bar-Abbas. We just call him Barabbas, but look in Matthew, his name is Jesus Barabbas. And I've got this Jesus the Messiah. Now, who do you want me to let go? What makes it even more fascinating is that the gospel tells us that Jesus Barabbas is actually an insurrectionist, and he's in prison for the crimes he's committed against the empire. Ah, the beauty of the empire. Even if your enemies are revolting against you, they can still be useful. And so what happens? The crowd says, we want Jesus Barabbas. Let's keep everything even. We can get along. And we know what happens. Jesus, the Messiah, goes to death. You see, these stories that we tell one another, that we come to remember, are incredibly relevant for everything that we face. That's why they're our sacred story. And this gospel in our tradition is not just something that's read to us, it's proclaimed. And we believe that when it's proclaimed, Jesus the Christ is speaking it again. And we come to this table and we celebrate that. And in our tradition, we celebrate the radical inclusion that that entails. So this gospel you've heard today, you'll hear again when Matthew's read in Holy Week. But you'll hear it every day, and you'll make that decision. Is it God's kingdom, or is it the emperor's kingdom? Who do you want to follow? Jesus Barabbas or Jesus the Messiah?